So a lot of my theories based on shows have a lot more room for error because unlike a movie that I might rewatch 5 or 10 times, I ain't got no time to rewatch a whole series 10 times over. But Llamas with Hats is a series under 20 minutes long in total, which means I could watch it over and over again until an idea popped up. If you haven't seen Llamas with Hats yet, go search it. It's right here on YouTube and only takes about 20 minutes to watch in full. Personally, I couldn't stop laughing at the fast-paced dialogue. I mean, Whitey's gotta pay and the payment is baby hands. Rendered me so useless, I was laughing for the next 2 episodes after that. But I tried absorbing this web series in a few different ways, and I think I have one that resonates with me. Ready to overthink this with me? Basically, things clicked for me with the hats. In this world of independent llamas, how do the llamas even get the hats on their heads with no hands and no appendages that bend that way? Okay, I'll give you that's an odd thing to fixate on, but go on this journey with me anyways. We do see that there are humans in this world because Carl stabs one of them 37 times in the first episode. But in episode 3, Carl claims to believe that Paul is a girl because of his hat, which started me wondering, where did the hats come from? Well, I think the answer is unicorn parties. If you have a super rich adult with a super spoiled kid, you might celebrate a kid's birthday by having a service drive out with a bunch of animals that the kids can ride on. It's very popular for those parties to include unicorns, which are strap-on horns put on a horse's head. But these services often have other animals that small children can torment for hours on end, including llamas. And to make these animals more inviting as a type of toy and not respected as a living animal, these llamas will often be adorned with things like hats or necklaces. So that means the hat came from the party business that Carl and Paul actually belong to. Now, you could imagine how much you might hate being sat on, kicked, pulled, poked, and generally mishandled for the enjoyment of little kids for hours on end every weekend of your life. Combine this with the fact that these are male llamas, and male llamas are known to be a bit on the insane side. They actually have what is known as fighting teeth. And apparently, they have been known to bite the boy parts off of other male llamas, which might actually explain why Carl thought Paul was a girl. Even if the biting thing didn't happen, I imagine they both had to be neutered or even castrated before they could be used commercially. But, yeah. If llamas will do that to each other, I can imagine llamas could develop a taste for human blood, or baby hands, or whatever. So on that end, the series actually makes more sense than it probably intends to. Obviously, we never see Carl or Paul going into a human kid's birthday party, but I think there's a reason for that. I have made up the scenario in my head that Paul was pretty seriously injured by a kid at a party, and Carl became a biter, so both of them were taken out of business circulation. From there on out, Carl presents Paul with these crazy stories and scenarios, all of which involve severely hurting the humans that Carl hates for hurting his friend. It seems like Carl has snapped, and all he can talk about is killing humans and how he wants to eat them. He is absolutely done with the crap they've put him through for 3 years, and he is happy in his fantasy world. Now, Paul is not getting any better from his unspecified, but likely internal injury, and he is not willing to play along with Carl's delusions. Paul is just begging for Carl to come back to reality and to stop talking about such insane things all the time. And in episode 6, Paul actually leaves the show, which could easily be interpreted as a trip to the vet to be put down. Then the party business, being a business that needs to make money, tries to replace Paul with a sheep, and Carl isn't having it. That blood canal could just be a metaphor for Carl ripping the sheep to shreds. And notice that Carl gets very upset that the sheep sits down, saying that Paul doesn't sit down, which could be a reference to an injury that doesn't allow Paul to move easily or without pain. I know I'm overthinking it. Stop leaving me comments. From here on out, Carl is now adjusting his fantasy kill everything world to include a new version of Paul. Carl can't deal with the loss of Paul, and that stops him from being able to tell his fantasy world apart from the real world, which is why Carl can't remember how he broke his leg and explain why the demonic mask can't do anything to actually help him. Because it's all in his head. Notice when Carl finds Paul's skeleton, aka reality, aka Carl is finally accepting reality that Paul was euthanized, the mask then goes from a floating demon to just being an inanimate object around Carl's neck. Much like Ryan Reynolds in The Voices, reality was a terrifying thing to deal with compared to his delusional world, and being met with reality caused Carl to kill himself. In the final moments of the series, his green hat is seen floating in the water. It's finally off his head. He's finally free of his human overlords. Thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoyed enough to like, subscribe, and share this video. I've also got a lot of other videos on my channel that you are fully encouraged to go check out. Plus, you can find me on Facebook at Say Halo Goodbye, which is my gamer tag, or Twitter at the_fanally.